Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. One of my favorite authors, and I have lots of them, is a man by the name of Mark Batterson, who's the lead pastor of the National Church in Washington, D.C., and he's written various books, but the one that I'm referencing tonight is called In a Pit with a Lion on a Snowy Day. In a Pit with a Lion on a Snowy Day. Now, isn't that the kind of book with a title that is intriguing enough that you would want to pick it up? But if you have that kind of intrigue, I'd be glad to lend you the book so that you can read it for yourself. For today, I want to reference a story that he tells, or an account of an experiment that was done at the National Institute of Mental Health in Washington, D.C. And this particular experiment is summarized on page 46. And here's what Mark Batterson writes. Doctors Annie Carney and Leslie Undergleider of the National Institute of Mental Health did a fascinating study asking subjects to perform a simple motor task, a finger tapping exercise. So these particular subjects were encouraged to do a finger exercise by tapping their finger in a certain way. And while they were tapping the finger in a certain way, they were taking an MRI of the brain so that they could locate exactly where in the brain and the tapping where the connection was made. And then they told the subjects to go home, and for 4 weeks they had a routine that they had to follow, tapping again and again and again for a certain amount of time. And then they were brought back in and they did an MRI, and not to their surprise but to their joy, they discovered that many of the people who were tapping, in fact all of the people who were tapping, actually had more brain cells in that particular area than they had the first time the MRI was taken. There were new neurons, new neurological connections that were made in each person who had been tapping. And tonight we're talking about renewal of our minds. Remember the passage in the 12th chapter of Romans where Paul talks about the fact that we should not conform ourselves to the world, or as Philip in his translation says, we should not allow the world to squeeze us into its mold. And then he goes on to say that we should be transformed by the renewal of our mind. Last week we talked about what it means to allow ourselves to be pressed into the world's mold. Today we want to talk about what it is that we have to do in order to renew our mind. Well, why is it that we have to renew our mind? What's gone wrong? Well, let me put it this way. In our world today, we have two choices. We talked about it last week. One choice is the world. In fact, we call it a worldview. What is your worldview? In German, which I like to quote just enough times to remind you that I do know a little German. And it's Weltanschauung. But the point is that the world gives us a certain way of looking at things, and then there is the other way, which is the kingdom. The focus of the world is on us, on ourselves. The focus of the kingdom is on God. If that's the case, it would seem to be simple, wouldn't it? In order for us to just say, well, look, that's a no-brainer. We're supposed to, as Christians, follow God. And yet, when we're honest with ourselves and take a good stock of our lives and look at it carefully, I think that most of us would conclude that we have been influenced in an incredible way by the world and its focus on self. You can just talk about the world in many different ways. For instance, the sexual revolution that has occurred in the last 20 years is incredible, and we referenced that last week for just a short period of time. But why is it that we have to renew our mind? Let me, if you have your Bible with you, or if you already have memorized it, let's turn to the first chapter of Romans, because we need to get back to the first chapter of Romans in order for us to understand what Paul was saying in the 12th chapter. And let me read you the first thing. The first thing that we have to recognize is that God has revealed himself through his creation. Listen to how Paul puts it. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them. What is known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world, and the things that have been made, so that they are without excuse. Do you see what Paul is saying? Paul is saying that creation, not just revelation in Scripture, that creation, if we're careful and look at it carefully, reveals who God is. Now that may not be a revelation for our salvation, but it is still a revelation that comes to us, and if we are honest with ourselves, we ought to wonder and marvel at the world, the creation that God. How many of you can make the sun come up? Remember the whole series of questions that Job had to answer when he was questioning God? None of us can make the sun come up. None of us can make the sun go down. Now, I read of an experiment that the Germans are doing. They're trying to replace the sun. And apparently, they've been successful in some ways. But I can't believe they could ever, even the Germans, I can't believe that they would ever be able to come up with a replacement for the sun. But the first thing that we have to recognize is that what Jesus and what God is saying through Paul is that God reveals himself through creation. And not only does he reveal himself through creation, but there is no excuse for somebody not to recognize that there is a creator, that there is a God, according to Paul. So that's the first thing that we have to recognize. The second thing, let me turn to the second part of this, continuing with verse 21. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking. See how he is already laying the foundation for what he's saying about being transformed by the renewal of your mind. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking, and they became foolish, had foolish hearts which were darkened, claiming to be wise, they became fools, and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds, animals, and creeping things. What is Paul saying? He's saying that there is no excuse not to glorify. In this translation, it is honor. In the NIV, it's glorify. And honor and thank God for what he has done. And yet, even though there is no excuse, each one of us in our own ways does exactly that. We have a tendency to think that we don't need God. And so we put him on a shelf until we're ready to take him off the shelf because there is some event in our lives that we can't handle ourselves. So the first thing that we need to recognize is that God reveals himself through creation. The second thing is that we have to glorify and honor him, but we don't. What do we do instead? Instead of actually glorifying and honoring him, we make idols. Here's what he says. We became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds, animals, and creeping things. Those are idols. We are, as John Calvin says, we are an idol factory. We are an idol factory when we don't glorify God for who he is in our lives. There is no choice that we have. Let me put it this way. Each one of us has been hardwired to love and to worship. The question is not whether we're going to love something or someone. The question is not whether we're going to worship someone or something. The question is only whether it's going to be God or something else. And we're constantly beckoned, constantly enticed by Satan and our own desires to do what? To worship idols. And Paul is saying, that's awful. Now here is the interesting thing. Not only are we to glorify and honor him, but we don't. But now the question comes, where does sin enter the picture? And most of us have been raised with the notion that sin is a concept, is something which we do, which will get God angry. Sin is, in one way or another, something that we do. And let me just read from Paul, because he says a lot better than I do. Because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie, and worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator. Let's stop there for a second. When we were created, when the creation was undertaken, God created the creation, including human beings. And the correct order, as we've already found, is that we are to glorify and honor God. But instead of doing that, we tend to seek the relationships which are on a horizontal level. Man, woman, man, woman. We try to fulfill our hardwired nature, or be true to our hardwired nature, which is to worship and love. But we do it on a horizontal level. And it will never work, Paul is saying. It will never work. Because we have failed to honor God, we seek our pleasure and joy and satisfaction on the horizontal level, and we will never receive the joy and pleasure that we could receive if we were to honor and worship God. But then something happens. Not only do people seek their enjoyment from man to man and woman to woman, not only does it occur on this horizontal level, but Paul goes on to say, precisely because we have refused to honor God, and precisely because we have refused to thank God, God now, what? He gives us up. Let's listen to the language of Paul. He gives us up. And since they did not see or fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased mind to do what those ought not to be done. They were filled with all manner of unrighteousness, man satisfied with man, woman with woman, animal with animal, so forth and so forth. Do you get the progression? It isn't that we have sinned and did all of these things and then God punishes us. It's the other way around. Because we are idol worshippers, because we don't live our lives on this vertical level, but live our lives on a horizontal level, God gives us up. And it's the result of God giving us up that we engage in all sorts of unnatural and sinful behavior. Is that making sense? It's extremely important for us to get the order correct. It's our idolatry, our desire to live our lives on our own terms, that actually causes us to live sinful lives. And it's important for us to recognize that particular progression. So what do we do? Well, experimenters that are referenced here and other experimenters have learned that it's not only important to learn something new, but that it's even more important to unlearn certain things. And it's more important to unlearn them because once you've learned something, and even if it's wrong, it will in many ways guide you, direct you, in some ways inspire you, but also lead you astray. So it's important for us when we think about transforming by the renewal of our mind, by getting the order straight, by getting this order into our head, it's important for us to recognize that there are certain things which we have unlearned because we've allowed the world to conform us to its patterns. And when we unlearn something, then we're able to learn something. I've been toying around with the idea of how can I express this in a way that might, in current terms, help us to recognize what Paul is talking about. And let me write it. What we need to do is repeal and replace. Do those terms mean anything to you? In the past few days, we've been talking a lot about repealing and replacing, perhaps not as successful as some people wanted or as successful as others did want. But it's applicable to our situation. It's applicable to each one of us. Here we are, having allowed the world to squeeze us into its mold, having given up the very relationship that is at the basis of any solid relationship with God, which is to honor Him and to thank Him for what He has done for us. And all of that kind of worldly view needs to be repealed in our lives. We need to get rid of it. We need to unlearn it. We need to say we have had an abominable relationship, so to speak, and we need to repeal that abominable relationship, pun intended. And we need to replace it. And we need to replace it with the right focus. And that focus is on God. You thought I was finished. We need to do one more thing. I was reading in a magazine or a journal that we've just received. It was an interview with a dissident from China. The article was Bonhoeffer in China. And in the article, the dissident who is now in the United States made a statement that really struck me. This was last night, middle of the night. It really struck me. The statement that he made is that when you believe in a country like China, when you are a believer, when you are a Christian, you know your whole life is on the line. You know that your whole life is on the line. Scripture tells us again and again and again that not one of us is permitted to treat our faith with our Lord and Savior as if it were an extracurricular activity. Our discipleship is not merely something that we add on to the rest of our lives. Our viewpoint about who God is not something that we just casually admit or dismiss, depending upon the circumstances and the people that we are with. Our discipleship is not an extracurricular activity. God demands our entire devotion. He hardwired us to worship Him. He hardwired us to love Him. And whenever we replace that, in an absolute sense, that doesn't mean we can't love somebody else or honor somebody else. What it means is that when we take our relationship or our idols and raise them up to a level where they have absolute authority over us, where they occupy our time, our thoughts, our desires, then we're treating our discipleship as if it were just another activity that we That's not the way God sees it, at least according to Scripture. So what's the worldview? The worldview is, first of all, creation. God created us. We have questions about where our origin exists or from whom we come. That's the answer. Shorthand way of saying that He made us. Second of all, there's the fall. We didn't specifically read the first and second and third chapter of Genesis, but the account of creation and fall is set forth there. And in the fall, we make ourselves God idols. And then third, there is the redemption. We'll be talking a lot about that and celebrating it in Easter, Good Friday, Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, and Easter. There's the redemption. God has redeemed us through His Son, our Lord and Savior. And then there is restoration. It hasn't happened yet. But Scripture tells us that Jesus is coming back and He will restore what God first created. Now, where do we live our lives? We have been created. We have participated in the fall, voluntarily or involuntarily. We have been redeemed by our Lord and Savior, and we will be restored. Our life is right here. We live our lives in between redemption and restoration. And God is calling us to be His disciples. Some people refer to it as living what has already occurred, which is the redemption. And what will occur, which is the not yet. As Christians, we live our lives in this area here, between what has already occurred and what will occur, what has not yet appeared. And next week, we're going to talk about what does it mean for us to live our lives already and not yet. But in the meantime, ask yourself a question. Have you made your discipleship a matter of priority in your life? So that it infuses every aspect of your life? Or is it an extracurricular?